I think Superman has a chance to upend Kang Dynasty simply because Marvel is a little oversaturated and people are getting a little worn out.
I think you're right.
And there's people that are falling to the wayside of like another, like, oh, this is the next Thanos. Now I got to watch another 17 movies. But everybody wants to see Superman.
Yeah. Marvel's at a stage where like you're either with it or you want nothing to do with it.
Right.
Because dang, it's too much.
Just like our viewers, ride or die. Am I right? 99 Nerds gang.
That's right.
Good point. Never thought of it like that.
That's right, Chuck. Hello there. Assemble.
Nerds, we are here for episode 30, Full House again with David, Shantacular, and A-Town Austin. We are here today to catch up on some information that we have been talking about kind of week by week, trying to figure out what the heck is going on with the DC cinematic universe. And we finally have answers.
Oh yeah, that was this week they put out a video, didn't they?
They sure did. James Gunn.
Gunderson of a Gunderson.
Got in front of the camera and told us what the plan is. So David is here to break down what the heck is going on with the DC universe.
So first, Dave, before you begin, I described it as they are nuking from orbit the DC cinematic universe. Is that still true?
Yeah, so basically we had our hearts shattered when they came out and said Henry Cavill will not be returning and forget everything you know about Black Adam.
Henry.
Forget everything you know about Wonder Woman and Aquaman and whatever, which maybe we'll get into, maybe. But yeah, they broke our hearts, but a little bit of time has passed. Our hearts have mended and we're ready to get hurt again.
Oh my gosh. So,
Jameson Gunnathan has dropped his DC slate.
Jameson Gunnathan is a great name.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to steal that from my son.
Sounds like a dog name. Yeah, he's got a plan and that's really all we really have been asking for. It's like, is there even a plan? Cause there never seemed like there was one, but Jameson has come on the scene and this dude's got a plan.
And I think it's cool. He, you know, after like looking at all these interviews he's done and all the different projects he's talked about, he really seems like he's a man of the people.
That's right.
He is one of us.
For sure.
He just wants a DC universe that's well thought out and put together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he has come up with a plan and he has released it. It is going to span over 8 to 10 years.
Oh my gosh.
See, that's what I'm talking about. Cause that's how Marvel does stuff. They're planning movies for my son to see when he graduates from college.
Right. He's actually come out and said his DC universe is more in depth than Kevin Feige's initial Marvel universe.
Oh my gosh.
I think that's accurate. Yeah, so
it's a bold statement, Cotton.
He knows what we've been through. He knows the world wants a well put together universe. He's even going so far to create movies.
Maybe if he's really successful with this universe, he can get started on the real one.
Mm. It could use some help.
Yeah. Pluto's just chilling out there. No friends.
Is it a planet? Is it not?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were talking about like Mickey Mouse Clubhouse or something.
Okay.
James Gunn, tell me, is Pluto a planet?
We need Goofy's backstory. James Gunn has come out and said he is going as far as to create movies, TV shows, comics, video games.
Oh, heck yeah.
Animated shows. And he said all of these will tie together beautifully. If someone is going to play an animated voice, that person will show up in real life as that person if it's portrayed in real life.
Yeah, same actor throughout consistently.
If there's a video game about Superman, it will be the Superman actor voicing him. He said he is going to be consistent throughout every type of media.
He's going to be consistent except for the projects that are already in works.
Oh no.
That are successful.
So yes, he's calling this the Elseworlds.
Mm-hmm.
Which is your Matt Reeves Batman. He's fully behind
oh,
it.
Oh, that's what he was saying. Elseworlds is non-canon DC stuff.
Yes.
Okay.
So yeah, your Elseworlds, you've got like...
So my fanfics are still protected.
Yes.
Good.
Absolutely. He said Joaquin Phoenix's Joker.
Yeah, so you got the Joker movies. We've got another movie coming out with Lady Gaga as Harley Quinn.
Yeah, that's the Joker. That's Joker.
Yeah.
With Lady Gaga?
Lady Gaga will be Harley Quinn.
Yeah. Dude, where have I been?
Yeah, I heard that today.
So I'm not going to act like I knew that.
But yeah, he's got... So the Joker is an Elseworlds. We've got Matt Reeves' Batman is an Elseworlds. There's a show out right now that I just found out about today. Batman and Lois. Or sorry, Superman and Lois.
Oh, wait.
Yeah.
Superman and Lois.
It's a show.
It's a show. But I don't remember that in the video he put out. Did he?
That's an Elseworlds.
I think that was.
Yes, okay. That's what I'm talking about.
That's a spinoff from Supergirl, which was a spinoff from Flash, which was a spinoff from Green Arrow.
The Arrowverse is another Elseworlds.
Yeah.
So he respects them. He's letting them do their thing. But he has come out with his own slate of things. And
it is all about the respect.
Chapter
game
one.
Respect game.
Chapter one is going to be laid out, like I said, 8 to 10 years of stuff. It's actually going to be 2 chapters, 8 to 10 years. But he's only come out and told us a little bit of chapter one, what's coming.
So not phase one.
It's chapter one.
Oh,
so he is
setting it apart.
Jameson, you dog.
Gunderson.
He's titling chapter one, Gods and Monsters.
Sure.
So it's a polytheistic chapter.
Yes.
Quite.
Very good.
Yes, quite.
Well, not, but yeah, sure.
And he has come out and blatantly said that this is not going to be another Snyderverse. This is not going to be a Gunverse.
Oh, man.
He said he's going to bring in directors, writers, and he wants their flavor to be tasted. He doesn't want it to be James Gunn movie. The same theme.
It's a weird way of putting it. Right. It's the right way to say it, but it's a weird way of putting
it. Like
James Gunn wants you to go to Flavortown, which reminds me, he looks like Guy Ferrari.
Yeah.
His hair is like a
little bit
like a white fire.
A white fire. That's White Fire Gunderson. That's what they call him.
Dude, it's not the Gunverse, but there will be guns. Am I right?
Yeah.
I hope so.
With the gun movie.
So like I said, it's not going to be the Gunverse. It's not going to be one tone throughout where... In the Marvel Universe, there is like one theme, one tone throughout all the movies.
There is, but they do give each director a decent amount of freedom. Think about Taika Waititi, Tutu Wakaka. He really put his own spin on his own movies. And then the guy who did Black Panther, you know, they kind of let him.
Ryan Coogler.
We've almost talked about like they stick to that 80%, 20% thing where like 80%, you got to stick to the storyline. But they get, I feel, and this number 20%.
And to be fair, it's worked.
It has totally worked. The 20% number that I just said is completely arbitrary and I made it up.
Good.
But I feel like it's pretty accurate. 20%, they give freedom to do.
Even if it requires constraining the directors at times and their visions. They have a very fine wedge they're trying to make sure everything fits into consistently.
I feel like the director's handed a list of like, these are the things, it's a 10-page list of these are the things you have to do in this movie. Okay. For the greater good of the MCU, this is our plan for this movie. And then they leave them, what would that be? Like another 1.5 pages blank of like, you can fill in the rest. But these have to happen.
Sure.
And that's all probably coming down from Feige and company.
He just treats these directors like they're third graders.
You got to sometimes.
Keep them in line.
Yeah.
You know what that's like as a business owner.
Titi Wukaka.
So they're planning to do 2 movies a year and 2 TV shows a year.
Okay.
All these shows are going to premiere on HBO Max.
See, I don't have HBO Max.
All these shows...
The shows. Okay. And the movies will end up hitting it, too.
Sure.
What is HBO Max's password sharing?
Oh, my gosh.
Noah, let's get him on and have him spread the word to all of our 99 Nerd followers.
So I sent a meme to Noah about how I've got Disney Plus from my brother Zach. I have Netflix from my brother Zach. I have Apple Plus from my mom. And then I have Prime Video. And then I now have HBO Max through Noah.
W.
All I'm missing is Hulu. And I sent him a meme of like the Thanos gauntlet, like one left.
Hulu.
I love it.
I actually have Hulu through Disney Plus, but it's not like the majority of the shows and stuff that's on there, I have to watch commercials through.
So HBO Max is kind of the Warner Brothers home base then, right?
Yes.
Appears so.
Does that mean they also are in control of the... Does Warner Brothers also control comics? Because I've never thought about Disney running the Marvel comics.
That's a great question, Sean.
Honestly, I don't think so.
Like, I ain't gonna go pick up a comic and read a book to learn more about the movies. You know what I'm saying?
Word. So one thing James Gunn is doing is for all these new material coming, his source material is the comics.
Okay.
Like, he is taking that and not necessarily carbon copying it, but he's using it.
From what I was reading, yeah, he was going to almost have that 20% freedom where he's using it as a template, but that doesn't mean you can read the comic and know exactly what's going to happen in the movie.
Right. One other Elseworld. So thing not connected to Gunn's thing.
Right.
J.J. Abrams is going to be directing a movie about a black Superman.
Is he really?
That is still happening.
Wow.
So,
okay.
Fly now.
Michael B. Jordan, step right up.
That'd be pretty cool.
It's always Michael B.
It could be Idris Elba.
Oh, heck yeah. I would support that.
He was fun in the Suicide Squad. I finally watched that for the first time not too long ago.
That was on our top 50 superheroes list. If you didn't watch that episode.
And I thought it was really fun.
Definitely tune into that episode. We had a blast doing that.
Mm-hmm.
That movie made the cut, and I heard it was good.
It's violent.
Oh, never mind.
Okay.
I'm a little boy.
Well, good.
I'm a young little boy who can't watch that stuff.
Now, is this, Dave, this is a comic you said, or is it an animated movie?
Or is it?
No,
live action.
It's live action. A real movie J.J. Abrams is directing.
Was there a date set for that?
No.
So there's another Superman J.J. Abrams movie. There's going to be a Superman and Lois animated show.
But both of those. No, that's a real life show.
That is a real life show happening right now.
Oh, man.
It's in like season two or
something. If there's going to be
a Superman legacy movie.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is already feeling a little discombobulated.
You're not wrong. It's kind of like, I mean, it's the same thing with Flash. Flash had the TV show established, but it's CW quality.
Yeah.
Production. So they're trying to clean it up a bit.
What does CW stand for?
Cartoon.
Well, because we talked about DC stands for doesn't count. So what does CW? can't win.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Okay.
So Gunn has come out and said these movies, TV shows are going to be all sorts of ratings. It's not going to stick to one. It's going to be family friendly. There's a horror movie.
Hopefully there will be a few G-rated ones from.
I mean, that's what Marvel has become. You know, as soon as they dip their toe into the Deadpool zone.
See, but that's the thing. They didn't make those movies. Logan and Deadpool. That was something else.
They're just
bringing them in. But
you're not false.
But there is some news that I have for you. James Gunn has come out and said, Ben Affleck will be back.
What? That's not true.
As a director.
Good. Oh my God.
Not Batman.
This is good.
So he's not going to be Batman, but they're going to bring him into work on a project.
I'll let him sit in a chair for a little bit.
Sure.
Not a long time though.
He directed Argo.
I'm going to say what I think I've said more than anything else in the history of the show.
Okay.
I've heard nothing but good things about Argo.
I've never seen it.
Me neither.
Okay.
Isn't that the little lizard animated show?
Oh, wait a second.
No, it's not.
I did see Argo.
Wait.
But I think I only saw 70% of it.
Okay, it's a movie based off a real life event.
Yeah, it's like a journalist gets stuck in a war zone, I think.
That happens sometimes.
Anyway, keep moving, David.
Okay, so Shazam is still part of this. The new Shazam movie coming out.
Yeah, Shazam.
Still part of it. He said Shazam's always kind of been his own thing, so he can still connect it.
Right.
And then Aquaman will be part of it, the new Aquaman movie.
Which,
that means Jason Momoa's got to still play him.
So, yes, there is some rumors about him.
I'd be bummed about that if I were Jason.
Jason Momoa met with James Gunn, and he didn't spoil anything, but he was real excited about something.
Right.
He hopped on Instagram and said, I am so excited for what's coming.
Right.
And a lot of rumors he was going to become Lobo because that was his favorite. And it's kind of like, how can he play two people at once? Aquaman versus Lobo.
Right.
James Gunn has come out and said, we are not going to have the same actor play two things.
Mm-hmm.
What?
But he didn't say
at the same time.
Oh my.
At the same time.
Aquaman dies.
Which leads me to think Aquaman dies.
And he gets reincarnated as Lobo.
Do you think that perhaps a black female character in the DC will trap Aquaman in her ship and dehydrate him to the point where he dies? Like our favorite Black Panther did to Namor in the MCU.
Water.
I think that would be something to talk about.
So Jason Momoa made the cut. What about Gal Gadot?
So yes, that is a maybe. She might be. We'll see.
Oh, a maybe.
And why is that, David?
That's one of the most confident things an actor could probably hear.
Well, we'll get to that later on. That's one of the things coming out.
Let's start off with, what are they starting with in this whole new world?
So
this brave new world.
Yeah. So Aquaman.
Shazam, you said.
Shazam, Aquaman. And then Aquaman, and then Flash is coming out.
Flashpoint. We've talked about this.
We have. James Gunn has come out and said this is going to be the best superhero movie of all time.
It's too bad it stars Ezra Miller.
Yeah, it is too bad.
And they're sticking with him. They asked, you know, what's going on with him, and they're like, he's in rehab, and we trust that he will be okay.
Love his Flash.
Hey, man, just take him to the Jordan, get him baptized. Everything can be forgiven.
Mm-hmm. He needs to be made new. I need to see the Snyderverse cut.
What if not only is Flash movie about like a reset for the DC, mm-hmm. but it's a reset for him?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's actually like he said that it'll be a reset for the DC, which obviously means Flash is going to travel in the multiverse, mess a bunch of stuff up, and then come back. And it's like, where's Henry Cavill? Where's Ben Affleck? Oh, this is a new DC. That's what's going to happen.
I hope so.
Yes.
Because that's exactly what they do in the Flash show. When things get too messy, he just goes back in time and resets everything.
Super convenient.
And it's like, wow, we went through 3 seasons of this storyline and now you're just restarting it. I feel like I wasted 3 seasons of watching your show.
You did.
I sure did. So to put it in perspective, the Flash, he came out and straight up said this will be the reset of the DCU.
Right.
Which means this is the Flashpoint storyline. Basically, what happens is the Flash becomes the Flash. His main origin story is that his mom dies. Okay. Right. And then throughout his life, he is becoming the Flash. He's learning his powers. And then he comes to realize that he can run so fast, he can go back in time.
Right.
So he comes to a point where he's like, I can literally run back in time. I want to save my mom from dying.
Right.
So it's kind of like Jenga, where you play a game of Jenga with your friends and, you know, the bottom piece is pulled out and then you guys play the rest of the blocks or whatever. And one of the last turns, you're like, oh, I'm going to pull that block at the bottom. Mm. And then you pull it and then everything above it, everything that started from that bottom block is ruined and crushed and you have to start over.
Right.
So it's kind of like that concept where he went all the way back, saved his mom, and now the tower of blocks has crumbled and there are different universes now and different because right. of the decision he made. So that's what I think they're going to do. It's going to create many different.
It's all coming together.
It actually all falls apart, and that's why he needs to go back, and then he ends up traveling to a parallel dimension. Right. And then he faces off against Reverse Flash, which I'm interested to see how they handle that character, because he's like the main villain.
What's Reverse Flash's power?
He is Flash, but reverse. He runs backwards.
Hey, don't run from the Lord!
No, actually, his suit is just color swapped. So Flash is red with a yellow lightning bolt.
He's yellow
with a red lightning bolt.
Okay.
And
it's never been done before.
Spoiler alert, he's the one that killed Barry's mom, Barry Allen.
Like on purpose or?
Double purpose.
Dang.
Like big time on purpose.
Like it was an accident at first, but he went back in time and did it on purpose.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
But that is a very, very, very good storyline. And I'm not pumped about Ezra Miller being Flash, but I am pumped about seeing that movie. So keep going, David. What else are they doing?
So the first thing they announced is going to be a animated show called Creature Commandos. It's going to be a 7-episode animated series written by James Gunn himself. Basically, it's a series about like these monsters who fight like it's like a historical context, kind of like Captain America, Wonder Woman. They like fight Nazis, like Nazi Germany type stuff. So it's an animated show, bunch of kind of misfit monsters that work together.
I thought I saw in the screenshot the Weasel.
Yes.
Who's in the Suicide Squad.
Yes.
What I'm excited about with that is some of Marvel's best content is their What If series and the animated series. And I think that this is kind of, it sounds like kind of like an obscure storyline, but for James Gunn to lead off with this, like this is his first project of his first chapter. I think it's probably going to be really good. That's my prediction.
Yeah, I agree.
Kal-El, no.
John, yes. But
from there, they announced there's going to be a Waller show, Amanda Waller.
See, now that I'm not interested in.
Me neither.
I like Amanda Waller. Well, let me put it like this. I could not like the character in Suicide Squad.
Mm.
I didn't like the character at all in her very brief phoned in cameo for Black Adam.
Right.
She is a little bit more interesting and fun in the Suicide Squad.
Okay.
So I will at least acknowledge that, because in Suicide Squad, the first, she is just like needlessly ruthless, and it just kind of is like, it subtracts from the story because you can't enjoy the scene she's in. She's just like overwhelmingly bad and mean. But in the Suicide Squad, it's kind of an ironic meanness. Like, she's ironically cruel, and the people she works with now have character, and they kind of like bounce off of her negativity in fun ways.
Fair enough. So her show is going to be a spinoff of the Peacemaker show.
Is that still happening, by the way?
John Cena. So season one happened. The Waller show is in between season one and two of Peacemaker.
Oh, so it's like your Punisher.
Yes. Which is better than any of this, but
shots fired.
But from there, we got our knockout punch. Those were little jabs to the stomach that anybody could take. But this one's going to knock you out.
Knock me out.
Take it. Punch this.
Superman Legacy.
Soups.
This is James Gunn's take on Superman. It is not going to be Henry Cavill or Cavale, however you want to say it. And this is not going to be an origin story. It's going to be a younger Clark, and it's basically going to be his Kryptonian heritage balanced with his human upbringing.
Mm.
And he's just a symbol of hope. And they really harped on this theme of how he's the most optimistic, kind person. So that's really what they want to show through this new Superman.
Maybe they're trying to undo what Zack Snyder did with Henry snapping Zod's neck. You know, yes. They're trying to really get the point across that their Superman is not a murderer.
Someone had to go. Someone had to die.
Zod had to die, apparently.
Well, you said it's not an origin story, though. So right. Is it like just past an origin story?
Yes.
I was reading up on this one a little bit because this is obviously what everybody's excited about. So James Gunn is writing and directing this one.
See, now how many things is he writing, though? Now, that's the only thing I'm starting to wonder a little bit. If he's like trying to be involved in all of the writing, that's
I don't think so. He's a lot. He's probably just picking the ones that he's most.
All the good ones he takes.
Yeah.
Right.
He's taking the biggest slice of the cake for sure. So it says this is a new Clark Kent. He's about 25 years old, and it says, now this is interesting, and I'm not sure where this ties into comics or like what's out there comic wise that's similar. The world is already filled with superheroes slightly older than him. I can't remember a storyline where Superman comes onto the scene and there's already people running around doing superhero stuff.
Dang.
Right. So that's interesting. He also did a Twitter poll. Did you see that, David?
I didn't.
He straight up put a Twitter poll out saying, do you want Superman with or without briefs?
What the heck?
Like, he's just throwing it.
Polls, wait, how about
just giving it to the people? Which do we do? Do we do the briefs or not? Because Henry Cavill's character did not have the briefs. And from the last I checked, I'm pretty sure briefs was winning in a landslide. So we're getting some tidy whiteys on our Superman, except they're red.
They're red.
Tidy readies, so you better get ready.
Well, It's good to know that we're in a place in this world right now where that's the kind of thing you can do a poll on, and it's fun.
It's fun.
Yeah.
So after Superman,
not like, hey, should I make it up to Henry Cavill? Yes or no?
He should not. There's 493,000, almost 494,000 votes, and Trunks looks like it won 59% to 41. Oh, then he followed up saying, by the way, this is for fun. We're not going to decide whether Superman has trunks or no trunks based on an egregiously non-scientific Twitter poll.
Hope you like pain.
Dang.
Oh, brother, this...
Thanks a lot, James, making me look like an idiot.
Why would they fake them out?
I'm also seeing a tweet from Matt Reeves. He subtweeted something that said the Caped Crusader will return to theaters in 2 years as the Batman 2, set in October 2025 release date. And Matt
Is it
Reeves
just
said,
called the Batman 2?
Part 2.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, look, man, with all the weird, like, the Batman, Rise of the Batman, like, I could just get down with 1, 2, 3.
That's what they're doing. Matt Reeves said, epic crime saga.
Yes.
Bat emoji, bat emoji, bat emoji.
Bat emoji?
Yeah. So that people have been arguing on the internet about. He called it a saga. What does a saga mean to you guys? How many
Star
movies?
Wars is
Six
a saga.
Six movies. Three original.
It's three prequels.
Three that are on the second half, and then you go back and you do three prequels.
Of his son.
Yeah.
And then don't do three sequels.
Yeah.
Six.
No, sequels would be his son. His son can't come before him.
Well, no, we need originals and prequels.
We're on the prequels.
Do it at he is the son.
Wait, who's the son?
I don't know.
Bruce Wayne is the son?
Well, I guess we're diving into Batman now. So
what's going to happen with Batman, David? That's all that anybody cares about.
There's a rumor that it's going to be a trilogy crime saga.
So a trilogy.
James Gunn's?
No.
Matt Reeves.
Matt Reeves. That sounds good to me.
Joke's on them. It doesn't matter what they want. It's about how much money it makes. Warner Brothers will squeeze those out as long as they have to.
Sean, I gave $13.50 to Avatar, The Way of Water.
Yeah.
So you better believe that I will give $39 at least to Matt Reeves' Batman 2.
If the ticket prices stay the way they are.
Yeah.
Give me 5 seconds on Avatar 2, real quick. Avatar 2 was amazing. One of the best movies I've seen of the year. I give it a 9.4 out of 10. You told everyone that I gave it a 9.
I thought it was a 9. You said 9.4.
No! Sorry, Dave.
Anyway, with that news that we're getting another Robert Pattinson Batman, we have more news that we are getting a James Gunn Batman.
Bring it.
New Batman, and it is going to be centered around the Brave and the Bold series. Which is all about Batman and his son, Damian Wayne, who they don't meet each other until he's like 8 or 10 years old, something like
right.
that.
Why not?
Damian Wayne is the son of Batman and the son of Talia al Ghul. Oh, cool.
Yep.
Was she keeping him a secret for all that time?
She sure was.
So that's low, man. Was she a villain or something?
She raised him as an assassin.
Oh my gosh.
And this
the League
kid
of Shadows.
This kid has no chill. He's a violent killing machine.
One of our hardcore listeners one time described Damian Wayne as a king kitch. And I can't agree more. He is a chotch miser. He is honestly my least favorite Robin. He's so annoying. But
I thought James Gunn said it was his favorite.
James Gunn said it was his favorite. So we'll see what happens. I mean, I really do trust James Gunn. I do. Maybe I'm wrong for saying that. Darn it. But if he says Damian Wayne is the direction they want to take and they want to have that Robin story, okay, do it.
I find I can relate more to a young person whose life has been hard growing up than spoiled rich. Bruce Wayne.
But none of the Robins were spoiled rich.
That's right. That's what I'm saying. Like the other ones were all like they had a tragedy. They were
you could like sympathize with them.
Yeah.
You can't really do that with Damian Wayne, but okay.
Yeah. So it's going to be like a father son type of movie.
Oh my gosh, Austin, you need to see Shang-Chi now. Think of the connections.
Oh my gosh.
Raised as an assassin ever since he was young. Dave, back me up on this.
I got to watch it again. I don't remember.
Shang-Chi's on my list, Sean. I mean, we'll get into it after David's done with the list. I want the listeners to know this, because all they hear me talk about is how things are on my list. I am moving through my list right now, and we can talk about that after, but I don't want to interrupt David.
I'm sorry,
Dave. He's cruising right now.
So yeah, this new Batman, it's going to be the father-son duo, but it's also, this is one thing he noted, it's going to open up the big screen to the Bat extended family. So like your Batgirl, your Nightwing, your... You know, all of them.
I mean, if you are bringing in Damian, then you are admitting... essentially that all those other Robins exist as well, because he's like the fourth one that shows up. You got your Nightwing, what's his name,
Dick Grayson,
Jason Todd, what's the other one,
Nathan Fillion,
nope, the one with the bow staff, Tim Drake, and then Damian.
Yep. So he said, you know, we've only ever gotten Batman.
True.
It's time to like get it on the big screen with these other characters.
I agree.
And the other thing they said, to kind of backtrack about like video games and stuff, they're going to have meaningful video games, but over the course of history, we have gotten video games based off of these crazy superhero movies, and they all suck.
Word.
Because they're trying to like carbon copy the movie.
Except and,
like,
for Superman Returns.
The movie, the game.
The movie, the game.
Well, I was gonna say, wait, that's not true, because those Arkham Asylum games like were... incredibly well received. They were so like gangbusters.
Well, no, those weren't, those were its own thing. Those
well,
were not.
Well, yeah, that's when they do their own thing, they're successful.
Right.
So what I'm saying is he's creating games that are adding to the DCU.
Okay. Oh.
It's not going to be.
Which is what Star Wars is doing with Jedi Fallen Order.
Exactly.
Okay.
So, you know, we might get this Damian Wayne Batman story, and then we might get a video game of Nightwing, his like origin. It's not gonna,
right?
This Batman movie isn't gonna be an origin of Batgirl, of Nightwing, of Tim Drake. It's not gonna be all of them.
Sure.
We're just gonna have them established, and then they'll kind of add to it throughout.
That sounds fun to me.
Different media.
I'd rather play a Nightwing video game than watch another show or on HBO Max about it.
Yeah,
I'm down for that.
So yeah, the new Batman, and then we got. So next, they announced a Lanterns TV show.
That's right.
So when I first heard it, I didn't really care for it until I realized what they were doing with it. This is going to be a like true detective show, and it's going to be about the Lanterns, Hal Jordan and John Stewart. And they're almost in like a, it's like a space cop type thing where they're going around trying to figure things out, investigate, you know, things across the galaxy. Like, it's honestly kind of like Star Wars, like the Jedi. Each Jedi is assigned like a sure. sector, and they're supposed to protect it. That's kind of what they're going for with this show in Green Lanterns. But to be honest, I don't know much about Green Lantern. I just know Ryan Reynolds played that role once. That's literally my only knowledge on Green Lantern. But
yeah, well, it's cool because it's Jon Stewart and
Hal Jordan.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool because it's always been one or the other. I mean,
which one's Jon Stewart?
Jon Stewart is the black one.
Oh yeah, that's right. Like from
the original
show.
Animated show.
Okay. Yeah.
And
yeah,
I like him way more than Hal Jordan. So
I don't feel like I ever gave Hal Jordan a chance.
Well, no, not even Ryan Reynolds gave him a chance.
Ouch.
Dang.
Somebody once made that, shout out to that guy who made a really good fake fan trailer for the Green Lantern movie once.
Yeah.
They did know about this Lantern show, that this show is going to play a really big role in leading into the main storytelling across all the movies.
Okay.
So that's going to be the show to watch.
Cool beans.
But next, they gave us The Authority is their next on the list.
I'm interested in this one.
Which is a movie based on a team of superheroes with extreme methods of protecting the planet that first originated in the late 1990s under an influential imprint known as Wildstorm. Basically, this is a hyper-violent Justice League.
Ah.
So
more violent than Justice... what were they called in Black Adam?
The Justice Society.
Yeah.
See, when I first read the tag to that, I thought maybe it was like a Watchers type of thing, like the Watchers of the Marvel Universe. This was the DC version, but it sounds like it's basically just a different planet's Justice League. Which there's a couple storylines like that in the animated show where they come across another version of the Justice League that are just like way more ruthless and hardcore, and Superman just kills people. Dang. It's like what the Justice League becomes when they just have too much power and they become unchecked. I got a better idea.
How about this? A movie where the Justice League has successfully stopped all the bad things happening in the universe and everybody just gets along for a while.
Dang. Sounds like a great movie.
Yeah. Then you got to find the real tension people have, like between each other, relationships.
Oh my gosh.
You know, there's nothing threatening their lives anymore. It's just about your heart.
It's just Batman showing up to like marriage counseling now and like helping couples through their...
Yeah, or like, you know, having to really connect with Damien, like, hey, I wasn't there for you, so now let's kind of work on this.
Question.
Son.
Do you think Pixar's Up is in the DC universe at all?
It would be under this new movie.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of.
I agree.
What's a fun little fact for you guys?
I love fun little facts.
The Superman movie, Legacy, and the Matt Reeves Batman movie are both coming out in 2025.
Wait, the second Dope. Matt Reeves movie isn't coming out till 2025?
Yeah. Correct.
Oh my gosh.
So it's going to be a big year for DC.
They're taking James Cameron's notes, dude.
I won't be around that long.
Sean, please do.
I'll be busy.
Yeah, you're right. That's going to be a big year for you.
I can't make plans that far ahead. A birthday is coming up, that's all I'm thinking about.
So then when do they after that, isn't it the Amazonians show?
Yes. What's cool though is, and I want to see what you guys think, in 2025 we're getting Matt Reeves Batman Part 2, we're getting Superman Legacy, but on the other side of the coin, Marvel is releasing the Kang Dynasty movie.
Who does better in the box office, Sean?
For the year.
It's Marvel. It's Marvel.
But well, are we talking overall, or are we just talking about these individual movies? I think Superman has a chance to upend Kang Dynasty simply because Marvel is a little oversaturated and people are getting a little worn out.
I think you're right.
And there's people that are falling to the wayside of like another, like, oh, this is the next Thanos. Now I got to watch another 17 movies. But everybody wants to see Superman.
Yeah, Marvel's at a stage where like you're either with it or you want nothing to do with it,
right?
Because Dang. It's too much.
Just like our viewers, ride or die. Am I right, 99 Nerds Gang?
That's right.
Good point. Never thought of it like that.
But yeah, for a clean slate to show up and be like, listen, we got a Batman movie and a Superman.
How
movie.
Clean will that slate be though by 2025?
That's a good question.
How many things do I have to have watched to have been caught up at that point?
Dang. Well, with the DC stuff, I think they're going to, I feel like the Superman movie will just be like, it'll almost be an introductory movie, even though it's not the first one. I think they'll treat it as such because they know that is where most people will be drawn to for the first time.
Well, but think about it like this too. Imagine you've already been invested in the Marvel Cinematic Universe so much so far.
True.
And now kind of jumping onto a new thing, you might not have time enough for Marvel's stuff.
That's
what it's like. Well, I don't know if I want to buy more tickets to more movies that I'm not seeing, or I get HBO Max, but I don't have time to catch up on all these TV shows, all these movies. It's like I'm in college. I've already picked my major. You know what I mean? I'm majoring in Marvel.
You're right. But now
I'm minoring in DC.
I think some people have picked their major in MCU and then they just found out they have 12 more years of school.
Oh, man.
And now they're trying to rethink everything.
Or they just found out that they're like, one of their friends who graduated with that degree isn't getting a job. And so they're like, well, I better switch now.
Or they saw the episode where She-Hulk has Megan Thee Stallion in her office and they're twerking and they say, what is this?
A little bit of MCU exhaustion, I think, is setting in.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Kang, well, this Ant-Man movie might.
It's going to set the tone. Sean, riddle me this. Get on your Googleplex.
Okay.
What did the Batman do at the box office? Matt Reeves.
Yeah, $770 million. Pretty good.
Pretty good. What did...
And by pretty good, we're talking about over three-quarters of $1 billion is good. Pretty good.
So Wakanda Forever.
That was in the 700s, I remember.
842. Mm. Whoa.
Man. I hadn't checked it in a while. Check Superman Returns.
Yeah, but there's more people on Earth.
Or no. I'm sorry. Man of Steel. There's more people on Earth. Yeah, but...
What are you talking about? there's more people
on Man of Steel.
More tickets sold.
The three-year-olds aren't going to see it.
668. Aren't they, though?
Okay.
That's pretty good.
I would say that the next Superman will pass 900.
Yeah, there's more people.
David, that's...
You guys, should we start getting into box office bets? Like doing like some of that where people do speculations about the box office and start
Absolutely.
Trying to make some money?
Dude, I think it's
as
all...
somebody who doesn't know anything about that.
Yeah.
It's everything's a simulation.
And I just pulled that 900 number straight out of my
These armpit. Guys literally make bets weekend to weekend.
Shoot.
It's crazy.
Dang.
They're like, oh yeah, I see Avatar dropping like 3%. It's like, get a life, man.
I think I saw Avatar Way of Water. I'm going to have to be checked on this, but
not after our podcast about it dropped, dude. Numbers went straight up.
I think Way of Water just hit number 4 all time.
I think you're right.
I think that was actually a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
I think it was like James Cameron officially has 3 of the, yeah, 4 highest grossing
and
films.
And Gamora is in those.
Yeah. She's,
she hitched her wagon to the right horses.
And Kate Winslet is in 2 of them.
Well, she doesn't count.
You're right.
She was barely in Avatar.
Water.
All right, back to the list.
Yeah.
They released the next series on HBO, Paradise Lost.
Okay. What does it mean?
So this is a drama set on the all-female island, which is Wonder Woman's birthplace.
Correct.
Themyscira.
But this is not a Wonder Woman project.
Yes. This is not Wonder Woman. This is a prequel to Wonder Woman.
So they said Gal Gadot may come back as Wonder Woman because this first project, really, she's not even involved. This is like before she's even born. It's like the origin story of her. Exactly.
James Gunn labeled it a Game of Thrones style drama.
Actually, that was the funny part about that video for me. I liked how he was like super frank and blunt about a lot of things.
Yeah. I'm telling you, he's a man of the people.
He is.
I think his plan is going to be great.
And he has a history of pulling obscure characters into the fold and having success with them, because I didn't even know the Guardians of the Galaxy existed until they made a movie. And
that was all James Gunn.
Now they're some of the best characters, and those movies are great.
He's probably going to kill off every single one of them in the third one.
Do what you got to do.
Yeah, just somebody's got to go.
Brand new start. Someone's got to die.
All right, Paradise Lost. Good for them.
Yeah. So it's going to be...
Sean's pumped.
Centered around like the politics and...
Oh, yeah.
You know, the scheming between the different like political figures.
Like a Game of Thrones Phantom Menace crossover, am I right?
Yeah.
Trade disputes.
Do it. Taxation of trade routes.
I must be frank, Your Majesty. There is little chance the Senate will act on the invasion.
Chance of Valorum seems to think there is hope.
If I may say so, Your Majesty, the Chancellor has little real power. He is mired by baseless accusations of corruption. The bureaucrats are in charge now.
What options have we?
And then we got Booster Gold.
That's right.
Which I didn't even know what that was.
Booster Gold.
Listening to what the description was, I am intrigued. It's going to be a TV series. It's going to be about a guy who is a loser from the future.
Okay. Yeah.
And all he wants is to be somebody.
Right.
He wants people to look at him and value him.
Okay.
And who doesn't? Who wouldn't want that, you know?
Yeah.
So he gets some future technology and he comes back to the past.
Right.
And basically uses his future knowledge and technology to be a hero in the past.
Right.
So it's going to be a show about a loser who just wants some validation from people.
I'm trying to think where I've seen the Booster Gold content, but I'm pretty aware of his character, and it's essentially that where like he has no business being a superhero, but he is because he's got the ability, and he's a pretty dynamic character. They've been throwing his name around for a while, and it's kind of interesting. It's cool to see they're finally following through with a project.
I like me a lovable loser.
Yeah,
that should be a good one.
Like Wreck-It Ralph.
Yeah.
Or Baymax.
Or Baymax.
Not really.
And then they announced Supergirl, Woman of Tomorrow.
Mm.
And this is going to be based off of Tom King's miniseries.
We'll have to read it.
So I looked up like the basis of his comics, and basically this Superwoman is going to be a like a darker, jaded Superwoman. Her whole thing is she was on Krypton when her people got wiped out. She watched everybody she loved get killed in front of her. She was tasked with protecting Clark. Her Krypton name is...
I am a princess of Alderaan.
Okay, so her name is going to be Kara Zor-El. And basically her purpose was to go to Earth, protect... her cousin Clark, and when she shows up, she realizes he doesn't need protection. He's literally the Earth's superhero.
Is right. this connected to Superman Legacy?
Yes.
So it's a sequel to Superman Legacy?
It's going
to
be after, yes.
Because I thought he was growing up on Krypton, all was well.
Nope. It's him growing up on Earth.
Oh.
But so she's going to be a so hardcore it version of...
is an origin story.
I guess.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. She's going to be a hardcore version of a Supergirl. Something we haven't seen, so. But
she'll be snapping Zod's neck.
Somebody's got to do it.
The neck will be snapped. And then lastly, on the slate, we got Swamp Thing.
See, yeah!
See, this now I know.
We're talking.
I know nothing about, and I have no expectations for what's coming. It's basically like scientist turned monster, but it's going to be a horror film.
Uh-oh.
It's like, to me, it's the epitome of a B-movie idea. So let's just do it.
Yeah.
That's what I say. Put a $300 million budget into doing a ridiculous B-movie called Swamp Thing.
Heck yeah.
But yeah, it's going to be in the horror.
Bring it, Jameson.
Genre.
So that's all exciting.
And that's it.
Is Swamp Thing a villain to anybody in any way?
I remember him in like the Batman cartoons.
But aren't you thinking of like, what's he called? He's not like, he's not Sandman. He's like Clayman, Mr. Clay or something like that. You know what I'm talking about?
Clayface?
Clayface. That's what it is. Clayface.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know anything about Swamp Thing.
I don't either.
I don't know a thing about Swamp Thing.
It's all just a little murky.
Hey, I have a question. In the Superman Legacy, I must have misunderstood. This is a teenage Superman or young adult?
25.
25. Okay, so an adult Superman, young adult Superman, on Earth growing up. He is not Superman yet. He grows up in a world that already has superheroes.
Yeah.
Is he still going to find Lois Lane? Or is this also, or is this more focused on like, hey, how does he get into the Justice League, or how does he get into the bigger fight? It's like almost like the Captain Marvel, the superpowered person who kind of comes right out of left field.
Sure. Yeah, I'm not sure what they're going to do with that. I don't think James Gunn is going to make it into a love interest of Lois, and I think it's going to be more of him becoming the symbol of hope for Earth, not him falling for a human.
I just want somebody to say, Superman, yours are the only legs I see.
Legacy. You know what? Now that we're talking about it, that actually is one aspect of Henry Cavill's Superman, where it's just like the Boy Scout, the do-gooder, the always positive. Like, Henry's character didn't really have that, and it's mainly because they immediately transitioned into
snapping Zod's neck.
Snapping Zod's neck, and then also the Batman versus Superman. Like, he was kind of like always trying to do the right thing, but I don't know.
He couldn't.
The tone of his character in that movie was a little weird. And even though I love Henry, I will admit that I'm a little more excited to see what this Superman's all about.
I mean, I kind of wish, I mean, if you think about it, I kind of want some superheroes to just be Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts.
Right.
Like, I just want some people to really be good people.
Right.
And the conflict doesn't come from their failures and flaws. It comes from doing the right thing sometimes costs you something.
Yeah.
I like that as a hero.
Right.
Like, you know, Superman's going to save you, but he's also not going to be like Tony Stark flirting with you.
Right.
That it's kind more of a thing.
Yeah. It's like Spider-Man has that tone to him.
Or he's not going to like insult you while he beats you up.
And really, if this were to all come out 2 years ago, I think I'd be totally against it. But you know what really has given me hope for a new character coming in and taking the mantle? Matt Reeves' Batman featuring Robert Pattinson. Because when they announced that project, I was like, come on, another one? Are you like, why are we doing this? And we've said it 100 times. Like, we walked into that theater. You, Sean, said, I just hope they make this worth it.
Yeah.
Like, if you're really going to do this, just make it worth it.
Make my day, I said.
And then, in my opinion, they hit a home run with that movie. So I have hope that they're going to hit a home run with the Superman casting. They're going to hit a home run with the next Batman casting, which, again, like, I love Robert Pattinson's, but you know what? I'm totally down for a new angle on the character. Yeah. And for you, I'm sure you'd love to see somebody with a little more muscle. And what's the dynamic with his son? What's Damian like? Yeah, let's get a live action Robin that's kicking butt.
I think this Batman's going to be more of like a laid back father figure. Not laid back, but more just kind of trying to calm or like instill.
He's trying to control Damian.
Right. Instill things into his son.
He's gonna be like Jake Sully.
Right.
Where like in all the other Batmans, like he's trying to control himself from becoming something that like, you know, he doesn't want to become. He's got to bring the reins in on Damian.
I hope they don't just go for the Joker as the villain.
No,
give me something new.
No. actually, I was reading in that comic series with Damian Wayne. It is, oh gosh, it's like the pig guy.
What?
He was in the video game. Batman pig guy villain. Professor Pig. PYG. Deranged enemy of Batman, broadly considered to be amongst his darkest and most disturbing. Pig is a twisted surgeon obsessed with the myth of Pygmalion and notions of physical perfection. Due to this, he kidnaps Gotham citizens to horrifically transform into his obedient Dollatrons. He's also the leader of the Circus of Strange. All right, Professor Pig. Maybe they'll go that route, David. Anything else to add about the DC? Negative?
Nope.
All right, well, I'll hit on real quick. I mentioned earlier, I have been moving through my list. Sean, I want to tell you something.
Please don't.
You told me Andor would be good, and you would turn me into an Andorian.
I don't think I said any of those words.
You did. I listened to the podcast recently, and I have to agree with you. I am an official Andorian. I got my passport, and it's official, the papers. I'm from Andor. I watched the whole series. I cranked it out. I told you guys I have a list, and darn it, I'm getting through it. Andor was very, very good. I really, really thoroughly enjoyed it. One thing I noticed was the sets in that movie were done extremely well.
Production design.
The production design was next level. Mon Mothma's whole house is just like next level. It's beautiful. The prison was done extremely well.
Yeah.
Just the sets I'm talking about. And then the last episode, the big crescendo to the season, the whole city shots, the wide shots, the overhead shots of the street where you got Empire versus citizens. That was all done extremely, extremely well.
You know, it's funny you say that because I'm just now remembering I just recently watched Rogue One again.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized how when they're on Jedha, mm-hmm. how claustrophobic everything felt. Because it's all so tight.
Yeah.
Like every tight corridor, and the camera never is zoomed out far enough. You don't ever see like big wide street shots like you're talking about.
Right. It was done well. And I love the prison storyline. The only thing that was disappointing, which I understand why they did it, because it kind of like leaves you on the cliffhanger. What's his face can't swim.
That's the best part though.
Andy Serkis can't swim.
That is the best part. I needed that knife in me.
You're just like, they're going to get out together.
That's right. It was perfect.
And he can't swim.
That is the darkest thing ever, and I love it.
He doesn't jump, and then he probably gets pushed. I think he gets pushed in.
Or he just doesn't make it.
You're so much better love. I'm thinking the whole time, like, dude, there's 80 guys. Just say it out loud. They can help you.
No.
No.
It wasn't about that.
I guess not.
Can't swim.
Can't swim.
No more than 12.
One
way out.
I really, really enjoyed that storyline. But I will say this, the pacing for me, as someone who binged it, I thought it was fine.
Sure.
So you were totally right. For the week by week, unveiling of these episodes, it probably would have been a little bit too slow. But for me to crank through that story, the prison storyline, I liked it a lot. The way I described Andor is what's really, really interesting is you see a side of things where almost like when you're tightening something down, you're using a ratchet strap to tighten something down your truck, classic manly urge to tighten it down and say, that's not going anywhere. Give it a little shake. This show is the Empire throwing a ratchet strap over the galaxy and just cranking it. Every episode, they crank it a little bit more. And then something happens and they double time crank it. And you just see them squeezing the citizens of these planets. And you see them overstepping with their power. And you see them doing whatever it takes by any means necessary to keep control. And then you just see how things start. You squeeze a bottle too tight and the water's going to squeeze out. And that's kind of the beginning of or the end of season one.
I hope you like pain.
Is you see stuff starting to ooze out of the bottle.
Yeah.
They can't keep it all in.
Well, I'm really glad to hear you say that. I feel very much like a dashboard confessional song.
You made me tune in. I had heard so many good things. I've heard nothing but good things, but it is now off my list. I finished it.
And you'll never watch it again.
Probably not.
Good riddance.
Probably not. But you're right. Andy Serkis was phenomenal in that storyline. I mean, just the way they...
Andrew.
The way they structure that prison. Mm-hmm. Like, it makes total sense. It's all a game. It's, it's your table versus those table. And I'm in control of the room. And it's my room versus those room. And it's our floor against those floors.
It really made me reconsider Warzone and Battle Royale.
Yeah.
They're just they're pitting us against ourselves.
That's right. The only thing that was driving me nuts was like the floors in the last episode. The floors were not yet disabled and all the prisoners are running around with no shoes. And the boots were right there. Like they escape and all of the guards' boots are sitting there. And I said out loud 5 or 6 times, put the boots on, put the boots on. I was just waiting for them to flip the switch.
Well, there wouldn't have been enough boots. Well, and I thought the big thing was he short-circuited their electrical system in the bathroom.
He did, but I was just waiting for it to turn back on. It never did. But like, okay, all these other guys are running around with no boots, but, Andy, Serkis, and Andor are going to throw the boots on, and then they're going to be okay. But they faked me out. They ended up being all right in the end until Andy Serkis couldn't swim. Poor guy.
If you put water on that, doesn't that make it worse?
It made it worse until it short-circuited it.
I gotcha. Okay. And then you said you were all about like the crescendo of the finale.
Yeah.
What crescendo? I didn't get a chance to talk about Andor. What the heck was that ending?
I really liked it.
I didn't. Either I'm deaf.
First of all, the score in that last episode was done beautifully because
the rebellion, like them all,
the speech
getting hyped up,
the speech that she gives, and you can just feel the boiling point reaching the top of the bowl, and it's just starting to overflow.
Right. And it was just I understand that part. I'm talking about right after that. What? He runs to Luthen, and then...
Yeah, there's a big... It's kind of a... It's chaos.
What?
Yeah. Well, I was watching it saying, why is he not leaving with his friends? Where the heck is he going?
Yeah.
And I guess he's just full on... I mean...
You don't have any friends.
What they're trying to connect is the speech that his mom gave him, and then the speech that she gave the town after her death with the hologram. I think he's like full on with the rebellion now where he's basically saying like,
I can't go and you can't stay.
Yeah.
The only thing about that last episode that was a little bit off for me was did you watch the Falcon and the Winter Soldier?
Yeah, I didn't.
You remember how at the end of that show, the Falcon, now Captain America, gives this like big speech to these leaders about how they failed society and they needed to do better.
Right.
But it just kind of keeps going.
Yeah.
And again, it goes on. It keeps going long enough to a point where it just kind of would. I don't care what he's saying. It would just make everybody. It just starts getting uncomfortable.
Sure.
That's kind of what I got with that. The mom's speech. Her eulogy just was like a little bit too long.
I could see that. Yeah.
To the point where you're like, kind of getting bored. Right.
Do you see they initially wanted to put an F-bomb in there in that speech?
Mm.
Or she said, fight the Empire.
Yeah.
She didn't want to say fight.
They don't say that word in Star Wars. That was a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. It wouldn't make sense.
That's true. What did I want to say? Oh, I think one of the best things that came out of that show, Luthen's ship is now my new favorite ship in Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
That dude's got gadgets on gadgets.
Just got lightsabers beaming out the side.
Dude, his speech to the spy.
Yeah, that was fire.
That was pretty. Okay, I liked Andor. I'm not trying to crap on it, but the finale, I was just like, what is going on?
I really like.
That's kind of how I felt. The finale was weird.
Yeah.
I really like Luthen as a character, but I think him escaping from that tractor beam and messing up those four TIE fighters, that was sweet. I thoroughly enjoyed that. I was saying out loud, what?
Cold-blooded.
Got him. Who is this guy? He's got, like, he has everything. All the artifacts.
He's got all the money and the weapons. Like, he was going to supply Saw Gerrera with the weapons.
He sold his soul to be like that, though.
And, like, you know what I was saying with Saw Gerrera, where he's kind of like a loose cannon, and he's kind of annoying in, like, the Clone Wars and stuff? I mean, honestly, Luthen is, like, a more heartless version of Saw Gerrera. Like, sure. He's just, like, cutthroat. He doesn't give a dang.
Call it what
and
you
I really like the Mon Mothma stuff.
I know you were lost, David.
It works all together.
Yeah.
It's just kind of like too sporadic.
Sure.
Oh, well.
Season one. I'm excited for season two.
Yeah, I want K2SO to hang out.
Heck yeah. I mean, we did get a droid like K2SO.
Yeah, choking him out.
Send him to the prison.
Yeah, that's no fun.
Yeah, that was messed up, the whole thing, because he gets sent for 6 years and he literally didn't do anything.
A single thing wrong.
Poor guy.
It's really messed up. And the heartbreaking part is like, yeah, that's what it would probably be like, wouldn't it?
Right. And then it makes total sense.
Wrong place, wrong time, 6 years.
Yeah. Wrong place, wrong time, off to work for us so we can assemble the Death Star.
And then, by the way, you find out you're actually never leaving the prison.
Right. You're just slave labor.
Yeah.
Crazy.
You get out and then they send you right back in.
Right. And that was the big uprising because they find that out.
Like, I'd rather die than keep doing this.
The very end of the season, there's an end credit scene where they show the pieces of machinery that the prisoners would have been working on. That's all they were doing. It was the exact same thing every single day. And they show at the end that robots are using those pieces as couplers for a grid that is connected to the Death Star. It is the assembly of the
Death Ray.
And I thought that shot was sweet.
Yeah.
Very well done.
Yeah, it was cool.
Slaving away at their own destruction.
Yeah.
It's messed up.
Very messed up.
Very dark.
Anything else you want to say, David? You know what? I just sent myself something on Instagram so I wouldn't forget. Ubisoft is making a Star Wars game. Offer a fully seamless universe. The game will feature a lengthy story driven by a fully customizable character that walks.
I'll believe it when I see it.
Walks a path chosen by the gamer. The game will boast a fully open, seamless universe. Players will be able to jump between systems, land it to space, akin to No Man's Sky, Star Wars version. That's exciting. We will likely have a full reveal of the game sometime this year. Boom.
I mean, how about this? I got a better question. Is there a single new detail about Star Wars Eclipse?
No. Nope. Isn't that coming out in like 2040?
Yeah, like I mean, I don't care, Ubisoft. You think I care about loading screens?
Sean,
I just want a game.
In 2040,
pull one out, you won't.
In 2040, what will the Xbox console be called?
Xbox Forever.
And which PlayStation will we be on?
PlayStation Forever.
Wow, that'll be really confusing if they did that. All right. Anything else? Cool.
Meanwhile, the Nintendo system will be like the Nintendo Splash.
And you can play it in your pool.
Yeah. Perfect. Nice. Underwater.
Oh, my gosh.
Actually, we did an escape room last night, me and my family. And I had a really good idea, which was the idea of, I'm like, wow, they should incorporate VR headsets in an escape room. Like, and it could be like, okay, you're in the room, but one player has to wear the VR headset to see parts of the room that other people can't see or something like that. That'd be kind of cool.
That would be cool.
Yeah. Actually, I'm going to cut this from the video because I don't want people to steal that idea.
Yeah. In case we open up a 99 Nerds escape room.
Yeah.
We will. Anything else, David?
99 locks.
Oh, nuzzles. We've got one more podcast, and then the next one will be Ant-Man.
That's right. Ant-Man coming in hot. We're going to try to get a guest on for next week. David is planning on having massive diarrhea next week. He will not be showing up.
It's not true, Austin.
And we were going to try to get a guest on. Maybe we'll dip into the TZ Noah pool. They're always down to clown. Yeah. All right. Well, anyway.
Make sure to...
If you do not like, comment, subscribe, I will
poop myself.
That's not true. Please like, comment, subscribe. We love doing this for you guys. David slaved away at notes today so that he would be fully prepared to talk to us about this. Like, subscribe, comment. Those are the things that I've already said three times. If you subscribe to this channel, I promise you will see content that is worthwhile. We've got 29 other episodes that we've logged at this point. We're just getting into the groove of things, and we're excited for the future, and we want you to be a part of it. So make sure you hit that subscribe button and comment what we want the people to comment. Trunks or no trunks on Superman?
Dang. Trunks or no trunks? Dragon Ball Z.
I don't get the reference.
Oh, you're not familiar with Dragon Ball Z, are you?
Not really.
Okay, well. Well, that's...
Okay, well, all right. Do you have a question for the peeps? Shout out to all the comments we got in the last video. People breaking it down and tearing you apart, Sean. Or maybe that was a couple episodes ago.
Yeah, I don't know. Who would you cast to be Black Superman?
Who would you cast for the new Superman? Who would you cast for the new Batman? I think those are the two biggest questions right now.
So... I feel like there's a better name than Black Superman, but how old is he supposed to be?
The Black Superman? Yeah.
Yes.
I have no idea. Okay. I had heard whispers of that project. I didn't know that that was anything other than an internet rumor.
And then meanwhile, the other Superman's in his 20s, and then we're talking about an older Batman.
You know what? I saw somebody...
Ironically, Ben Affleck would probably be perfect for...
You know what? No, I think it is a somewhat like mid-30s Batman. Gosh, I just saw...
With a teenage son?
Yep.
I don't know about that.
Most likely mid-30s.
What?
In the comics, he was 43, but it's not 100% based on the comics. That was...
Why is he got a teenage son?
That wasn't from James Gunn. That was from a prominent DC Instagram account.
Unfollow that account.
I mean, I've got a 5-year-old son. I'm 31.
Yeah.
You know what I had to do the other day?
In a few years, your son's going to be a teenage assassin?
Dude, don't you dare question Oliver's abilities.
Are you telling me that when Batman met Talia al Ghul, he was a teenager?
No, he was oh, yeah, maybe.
I don't believe you. That's what I'm saying.
No, maybe he was 20, 21. And then this Batman is 36. 37.
Honestly, throw this whole thing out, James.
Dang.
Gunderson.
Jameson.
Son of a Gunderson.
Well, that's going to wrap it up. This has been fun. We're excited to see that the DC finally has a plan. It has a man in charge that we somewhat trust right now.
Hey, I'll say this. I've always been poo-pooing DC.
We all have.
For like more so than any of you. In fact, I try harder to poo-poo it than you do. And I watched that video with Mr. Gunn and I thought,
he's a good boy.
Wow. He's a good boy. Let's do this.
You know what I'm thinking? So he wants to bring Damian Wayne in. He wants to bring in Batgirl. He probably saw 10 seconds of that Batgirl movie and said, guys, this ain't it. Cut it.
Take her out back and kill her.
There you go.
No, James, we got this whole movie. It's like already done. I said, kill it.
Dump it.
All right. That's going to wrap up episode 30. We love you guys. In Jesus' name, peace. Shaka Paka.